How's everyone doing? See some great familiar faces from 3 years in the program. All right.
Hello.
All right. For those who have not experienced monologue night before, the way things work here is we start with the ninth grade. This is the order that we're going to go. The ninth grade, two groups will come up. In between each monologue, we snap. We don't clap until they come for their entire group curtain call after each group goes. They'll then exit, the next group will come up, and the same thing, so that we can keep the evening flowing smoothly. Because I have a captive audience, I'm going to do the teacher thing and take advantage of it. Those parents who have not signed up for the remind, it's on. They're very used to me. I put all the information on the back. If you could sign up, it is really, I don't send a lot of reminds, but it is a great way for me to remind you if your son or daughter tells you they have no homework or no test or anything like that. Sometimes a reminder will actually come out and say, don't forget about the big test tomorrow. So it's very helpful. So that's all the information is listed there. Also, if you weren't aware of the Hamilton trip, we're going to see Hamilton in Chicago because, of course, we can't touch tickets here in Detroit. The prices are there. It's March 28th, which is a Thursday. We leave in the morning. We take a charter bus. We see the play and the musical in the evening, get back on the bus, sleep, get back here at some ungodly hour, like 4 or 5 in the morning. But the good news is it's a half day of school that Friday and then spring break, so I think we can all survive. But I am going to open it to students outside the program starting on Monday the 28th. So if you are interested, please take advantage of that. This is only for those going to New York in April. The next payment's due January 25th. And the last one, and I know you're very, very sorry about this, I will not be able to attend conferences this year because we have our little shop of horrors opening. March 8th, 9th, and 10th, and the 7th will be our final dress rehearsal. So I know you're going to want to meet with me, hopefully some of you. I get lonely to see the parents. But if there is an issue, please email me and we can set up a mutually convenient time. All right, so I think I did all right. My guest tonight, I always guess what the length is. My guest tonight is 91 minutes. Let's see how we do. Now, without further ado, let me welcome to the stage the first group of ninth graders.
I had some stuff written out to say about Kimberly, about what she meant to her classmates, her friends. But when something this bad happens to someone that good, I don't know what anyone can say that makes any difference. Except that in her dying, in the really bad way she died, she changed our lives. Kids that never liked each other much. I see them here, today in this church. I see them hugging each other and talking to each other. Probably some the first time ever. And if you maybe add up all the good things she did in her short life, all the smiles she gave, all the songs she sang, all the kindness she did. Well, you hear people say you don't get something for nothing in life, but Kimberly, she gave us a whole lot of something every day she lived and never asked a thing in return. I figure now we could start giving back.
So there's this guy in my history class who, about once a day, gets up in my face, grins like a fool, mumbles my name, and then walks away giggling. That's it. Is he just your basic wacko, or is this some special form of guy language mating code that means he likes me or something? Am I supposed to be impressed? How do I even respond? Giggle back, kick him in the shin? I have no idea. It's like once I entered middle school, all the rules change. I'm contestant in this bizarro game show where all the other players are playing a different game, but you're the one who gets the pie in your face. Hey, maybe that's what I'll do. Next time he gets in my face, I'll smush a Twinkie on his nose and see what happens. Then I'll have to figure out what I meant by that.
I always took their work for granted to be simple and unimportant. I wasn't proud to be working there at the beginning. I was only glad to know that because I was educated, I wasn't going to end up like them. I was going to be better than them. I wanted to teach them about sexual liberation, about the women's liberation movement, and all the things a so-called educated American woman should know. But in their subtle ways, they taught me about resistance, about a battle no one was fighting for them except themselves, about the loneliness of being a woman in a country that looks down on us for being mothers and submissive wives. With the work that seems simple and unimportant, they taught me about resistance. Perhaps the best thing they taught me is that women are strong. That women are strong, and especially when working together.
When I started dating Rick, he was such a sweet guy. He always walked me to class and sent me little notes. He made me feel our friendship was really special. Lately, I don't know. Like yesterday, he was standing at the drinking fountain with some of his guy friends. I walked up and said hi, and he just glanced at me, then looked away, like I was a stranger. Then I asked him where he'd been at lunch because he didn't sit with me like usual, and he says in a real nasty voice, "I was shooting hoops with my buds. That all right with you, or do I gotta ask permission first?" His friends all snickered, and I just kind of slunked away. Then after school, Rick wants to hold my hand and walk me home like nothing had happened. Maybe it's just a guy thing, but it reminded me of how my dad treated my mom, and I'm thinking, nah, I'm out of here. I'm so out of here.
Let's see, which will it be this time? Stoner? Surfer? Beamer? Goth? Maybe I should get some old-time religion and join the Christians. Shout, hallelujah! My dad's business takes us to a new town about every 18 months. This is like my 32nd school and I'm not even out of 8th grade. What usually works is to make friends with the most non-threatening people and stay in the background, stay out of the way. But that's harder to do the older you get. Everybody's threatening. You need backup to keep from getting hassled. They don't let you be in the background. Everybody's gotta be in the show. Let's see, juicers, jocks, gangsters, alfalfas, hippies, geeks, bowheads, preps. I'm flexible. They're all the same, really. Little tribes with their own little rights, their own dress codes and talk, their own dirty little secrets they gossip about and try and hide from their cliques. My dad always asks me, "What'd you learn at school today?" Basically, survive.
If I went to college, I'd be the first one in my family to ever go, which is really cool, but kind of weird. I mean, it's not like my parents are putting pressure on me one way or the other, but I don't know. I don't know if I can handle college, and if I don't, I mean, what if I screw up and can't cut it and have to bail? Sure, I'm as smart as the kids I know who are going, and I had a good SAT score, and they'd offer me a scholarship, but I don't know. What if college isn't, you know, for me? Will I just make things worse for everybody instead of better, the way college is supposed to be?
Can you keep a secret? Okay, this must be secret. I think I'm losing my hair. There just seems to be more on the brush than before, and the shower drain gets all clogged. Ugh. Yeah, I know it's gross. Don't you see? I'll never be, you know, loved. Shut up. This is serious. Prom is coming up, and what if I'm bald by then? My chances are already slim of getting a good date. Now I'm in serious jeopardy. In college, forget about it. No fraternity will want me. I'll go from being 16 to 40, thinking about rules and how many miles per gallon my car gets. Wait, what do you mean shaving? I do owe you about a million favors. Wait, what if my head is misshapen? Where are you going?
So creepy. Rubber dub dub, three men in a tub? Really? There was a woman who swallowed a fly. I don't know why she swallowed a fly. Perhaps she'll die. Are you not listening to what you're saying? For example, what's the last thing parents say to their kids before they go to sleep? Don't let the bed bugs bite. Now I have nightmares of getting eaten by bugs. Is it really that hard to come up with something original? Really, I thought these stories should have a meaning, but no, parents! Our parents would rather torment our minds with rhymes from a sick, twisted childhood. Well, sleep tight and don't let the bed bugs bite. Darn it.
Twice a week, I've got gym. Or gym's got me, I should say. Twice a week, I have to get undressed and shove my good clothes in a cramped, mildewed, smelly locker and put on this ratty-looking outfit and get all steamed up and sweaty and take a shower with a bunch of screaming, giggling girls who stare at my boobs. It's a humiliating, disgusting mess that doesn't prove squat. My gym teacher is Miss Strickland, or Ms. Strickland, I mean, with a big deep accent on the Ms. The woman has muscles in her hair, I swear to you, and a real deep voice that sounds like it's coming from the bottom of a drain pipe. She was an athletic whiz in college, and she thinks everybody's as strong as she is. The other day, she had me trying to climb a rope to the top of the gym. What am I, a monkey here? Besides, what's it prove? How many times in her life does a woman need to shinny up 20 feet of hemp?
Dad? Oh, wow. Thought I'd get the answering machine. Usually still at work and die. Did I want to leave a message? Not exactly. I just thought, you know, I'd say hi, so hi. Just driving around, had a couple errands. Oh no, I'm not driving now. I'll never drive and talk on the phone. Oh no, not a problem. Dad, I'm completely not driving. Where am I? Just take your break from driving. Yeah, on the side of the road. It's a safety thing. Take a break once in a while, keep your reflexes sharp. You sure do need those sharp reflexes. Pardon? That noise? It's a truck. Looks like a truck. Definitely a truck. Right, a tow truck. Sure is. How'd you guess? What is it towing? Looks like a car. What kind? Let me get a closer look. It's sort of a four-door. Wow, that's amazing. It's my car. Incredible. It sort of looks like a scratch on a fender, maybe both fenders. And the passenger side? Gee whiz, I'm sure glad I'm standing at the side of the road. It looks pretty serious. Well, not too serious. Pardon? Well, I did have one question. Do you think this would count against me getting my license next month?
I look around, and I don't see very much happy. Happy is largely absent from the sphere of existence. Who do you know who's really happy? My parents are. My brother and sister aren't. My friends aren't. And neither are any kids I see at school. Teachers? No way. Can you even say a dog or a butterfly is truly happy? People in the supermarket, the mall, on the streets, even at church, none of them are happy. So I don't think it's just a teen thing, a phase. And the more people tell you to be happy, the more unhappy you get. That's like the law of perverse mental physics. Because if you truly believe happy is the natural way of things, and you're not insanely, berserkly happy, you'll get more depressed and miserable till you're drowning in a swamp of wannabe happy, but can't because your emotional dipstick is stuck in the mud at the shallow end of the gene pool. So maybe everyone should stop working so hard on being happy. Maybe they should work on being okay. In fact, I think happy is way too much to ask of anybody, especially the people who are hopelessly cruel and greedy and always starting wars and dumb trading card guides. From now on, I want the world to just be okay. Less happy, more just okay. Wouldn't that make you happy?
Summer is not all it's cracked up to be. It's hot. You have to wear shorts and tank tops. I hate shorts. I feel like my butt is hanging out the bottom 2 weeks before I even get used to them. You have to shave all the time. God, I hate that. You have to think about which bra you wear because otherwise the straps will show depending on what shirt you put on. Give me cold weather, sweaters, layers, long pants, anytime. And don't even get me started on the swimwear. We'll be here for weeks. Oh God, they're coming. Try to look casual. Try to like, all right, let's turn on scared of everything from the minute I wake up in the morning. I get up an hour before you just to check if you're still there. I know Grandma's dead. I know she probably can't hear me. But I still speak to her every day anyway because I'm not so sure anyone else is listening. If I have to go for an interview, my heart pounds so much you can see it coming through my blouse. That thing about writing my name on the ballot stubs, it wasn't my idea. It was Gordon's. He did it first, so I just copied him. If you want the God's honest truth, I don't even want to be an actress. I don't know the first thing about acting. I don't know what I want to be. I just know I wanted to come out here and see you. I just wanted to know what you were like. I wanted to know why I was so frightened every time a boy wanted to reach out and touch me. I just wanted someone in the family to hold me, Libby, and not someone who wasn't there. I want life to be fair. Is that so much to ask? That day, that was a very bad day for me. All things considered, my brother ate the last of Cocoa Puffs and drank the last of milk for breakfast. Both unfair events, because I was the one who went to the store and bought those items when they ran out last time. First period, Mr. Klesko marks me tardy, which I admit, I was. But so was Rebecca Halloran, even more tardy than I was. But Mr. Klesko happened to not be looking when she snuck in, so she didn't get marked late. Then, unfairness to top all unfairness, Miss Moore, that lovely geometry teacher of mine, decided that the questions on this extremely heavily weighted test she had fed
should have nothing to do with the homework we had been doing for the past 2 weeks leading up to said test. Unfairness bothers me. So normally, some boy bozo, and generally all boys are bozos, decides he wants to fight some other boy bozo, and the first bozo was clearly more qualified to pound the stuffing out of the second bozo. In other words, if the match of the bozos was completely unfair, normally I wouldn't have cared. But that day, I could not keep myself from taking a stand to try to diminish just slightly the lack of equity in my world. And what do I get for my efforts? Sarah Dobson, whose nose rarely drops below an upright angle of 120 degrees. I am very good at geometry, by the way. Sarah chooses to call me a stuck-up witch, and I didn't even get the chance to pull her hair out. Unfair.
I just thought she would be my life forever. I still think about her, even now. It just seems impossible that my best friend, someone the same age as me, could be dead. I still expect to see her in school. Every time something funny happens, I turn around to share a look with her. Because she would always understand. We always thought the same stuff was funny. Now, it's like I'm the new kid at school. She was the only one I ever really hung around with. I didn't need other friends. And now I have to go back there. I don't know anyone anymore. I don't know what to do. There's no one else like her. I'm going to be all alone from now on. Don't feel sorry for me, Mom. Don't. I just have to get used to it. And I will. I'll be independent from now on.
I was graduating from Vassar in primary education, provisional junior league. Sleeves right down to my elbows, prim, high, proper collars. Already been offered a boarding school position for the fall term when I saw Red Cross forming a placement for me. I went to an interview, and they said Red Cross has two groups going overseas early summer, Korea and Vietnam. Wow. So I get a sophisticated, cosmopolitan city, they say. Diversity of people to meet, all walks of life, and they speak French. I took my junior year in Paris to see. Besides, it snows in Korea, doesn't it? Whereas Vietnam has this wonderfully warm climate, I'm told. I went home for the weekend to tell my parents. But Dad, Mother, Vietnam will be my year of service. Besides, if I'm ever gonna do anything in my life besides being old maid boarding school teacher, I better do it now. It grew very quiet in the breakfast room. Sunday morning, Mother's coffee cup rattling in its dressing saucer. Look, Whitney, if you insist on running off like this to the ends of the earth, do be aware you make a decision of some consequence. There will be repercussions on your life, not necessarily for the better. So please, dear, please do think it carefully through. But Mother, don't you see? I already have.
My name is Dennis Gandelman. Around this school, I am the object of ridicule for most of the students, simply because I have an extremely high IQ. It's 176. My father wanted me to enroll in a special school that deals with geniuses like myself, but Mother was firmly against that. She wanted me to have a normal education, not be treated as some kind of freak, which is ironic, because that's exactly what's happened to me here. The whole concept of education is a paradox. High school is supposed to celebrate education and wellness, but what it really celebrates is social groups and popularity.
So, the other day I was walking through the hall and out of nowhere I fell. It wasn't just a stumble, it was a faceplant. I was really hoping that no one noticed, but as soon as I picked my head up, I saw a huge puddle of blood. My nose was bleeding. You would think someone would maybe stop and help me, but no. I'm laying here, blood shooting from my nose, and not one person will stop and help me. So, now I have to work with the nerve to go into the closest classroom and say, hey, I just fell in the hallway, now my nose is bleeding. The teacher just freaked out and sent me to the office. The principal was more worried about the fact that no one helped me than my nose gushing blood. He was so worried, he called all the classes down and made assembly all about who the other students would be. Maybe if he had the assembly sooner, we wouldn't have had his problem.
Who teaches boys how to hit on girls? Seriously, is it their dad, their brother, their friends? Well, whoever is giving these boys this advice is seriously challenged. I mean, tapping your pencil on the desk next to me until I snap and break your pencil in half because you think it's fun to annoy me is the wrong way to get my attention. And the hair plunk as I walk past in the hallways is getting old. I mean, come on, we are not in third grade anymore. And when does chivalry fall on his sword? I wish you would just be yourself, because the nice you, the you I knew a few years ago, I liked him.
Congratulations, Mike. You deserve it. The best person won, I guess. Mom and Dad, can we just go home now? Because I'm trying really hard to hear you about this, but I'm really upset. I don't want anyone to see it. I deserve that award. I worked hard all year. Don't just kiss the teacher's butt. I know it sounds like sour grapes, but I really think it's true. My science fair project was way more labor-intensive and difficult. His was easy. He never takes chances. I participate in class. I busted my butt all year, and what do I get for it? Nothing. What a complete waste. Goodbye, scholarship. Goodbye, decent college. All because I couldn't be a kiss up like that moron. Listen, you could just stand here and chat with the parents, but I'm getting out of here. I'll be in the car.
I didn't think it would come to this. Though my friends warned me, I just can't believe some girl is gonna beat me up after school today because I'm dating her ex-boyfriend. I mean, we're not even really dating. It's just, he asked me out and I said yes. And we went to the burger place on South Main for like an hour. In broad daylight. I mean, nothing physical happened or anything. We just talked and had a burger. And then she bumps me in the hall third period and says, I'm seeing you later, I'm back. My friends say, she's only scaring me, or maybe she won't be there, or maybe I can call a cop and get her ride home. But she'll be waiting after school, or the next day, however long it takes. That's the way people like her are. They've got nothing to lose. I don't even think she goes to school here anymore. She just looks for people to beat up. Jesus, where are my friends now?
Report cards came today. I had 5 A's and 1 B. First thing my mother says, what did you get the B in? Let's see, Mom, is it my imagination or do my failures attract more attention than my successes? Because it's always that way with her. I sort out 5 piles of laundry. 1 pair of socks is mismatched. It's major conversation for the next week. What about the other 50 pairs of correctly matched socks? They don't exist? I mean, who's keeping score, Mom? Who's handing out the prize for total perfection? Is God keeping track in some big balance book of everything I do? 10 mismatched pair of socks equals a mortal sin, equals 3 extra months in purgatory. When I do something right, be proud of me. Or maybe I'll just quit bothering to do anything right at all.
Okay, but I still think eating in your car is gross. I mean, how come you can't just wait until you get home? Or stay and eat at Burger King or wherever? Come on, people can't be in that big of a hurry. Yesterday, my dad and I saw a woman eating a whole meal in her SUV. No kidding. And she was using the steering wheel for a table. And she was weaving all over the freeway. My dad says there should be a law against eating while driving. He thinks the same for talking on cell phones, too. When I told him your mom sometimes eats a hot dog when she takes us home from school, he said I can't ride with you guys anymore. Yep, he's taking us home from now on. You might want to ride with us. This way you won't wind up in the hospital covered in mustard.
feel sorry for you, but I won't. You deserve to fail, and it's not my fault. Why am I responsible for you? I was supposed to do your homework for you, help you through, let you cheat off me because we're best friends. Maybe you're not my best friend, though. Maybe a friend wouldn't always ask that kind of thing. It makes me, like, support your problem, so you'll graduate stupid. How does that help? How does that make you my best friend? I know you think I betrayed you, but I can't do this anymore. And if that makes you hate me, well, I guess that's just the way it'll be from now on. I'm starting to feel like a sucker for letting you use me for so long. No more. You'll have to find a new nerd to use from now on.
Yeah, what do you want?
Sorry, sir. What may I get you?
Listen, maybe my attitude is bad. Have you ever had to stand on your feet for 12 hours, hauling huge trays over your head, walking in and out of a kitchen that's about 150 degrees? I didn't think so. I didn't think you could have, or you'd have a little more respect for me. Are you really so dumb that you think that all those perky waitresses actually think you're really nice and cute? They want your money. Hey, I'm just being direct. I don't pull any punches. I'm honest, probably the only honest waitress you'll ever meet. And maybe you don't like me, fine. But if you order sometime in this century, I'll get your food while it's hot. That's my job, not flirting with some middle-aged divorced dude who still wears loafers with no socks. So let's get back to the beginning. What do you want?
Guys got me totally confused. They're so possessive. As soon as you start to talk to a guy, he thinks he owns you. All of a sudden, you're not allowed to call anyone else, ride in a car with anyone else, or even smile at another guy. Just what does the word date mean anyway? No one my age uses that word anymore. I guess our generation has its own vocabulary. According to my mother, dating is when you really like one guy, but there's no commitment, so it's okay to go out with another guy if someone asks you. I thought that's what talking to someone meant for my generation, but it hasn't been working that way for me. Take this guy I've been talking to. We decided we wanted to see each other, but not be considered as a couple or going out together. That was cool with me. I have lots of guy friends I like to do things with, so the idea of being with one guy exclusively is nothing I'm interested in. Sure enough, as soon as this guy heard I was talking to another guy from work, he started flipping out on me. I was like, okay, are you and me suddenly a couple? Of course, he said, no, but doesn't mean you're supposed to be talking to other guys.
Please, tell me. Please tell me it's okay to not wear the same clothes as everybody else, or like the same music, or have the same hairstyle. Please tell me it's okay to think my own thoughts and not feel them stupid and worthless. Please tell me it's okay if I laugh too loud or cry too hard or care too much. Please tell me it's okay that I don't find true love right this minute. Please tell me it's okay that I don't know what I'm going to be when I grow up. Please tell me it's okay to not be popular with everybody in school, and I don't have to hurt somebody else to be popular. Please tell me to be patient. Please tell me to hurry up. Please tell me to slow down and look up at the stars and dream about flying across the universe. Please tell me that war is going to end and racism will stop. And the present will become the future and leave the past behind. In the dictionary, it won't carry words like kill or greed or hate. They'll be unlisted and forgotten when evil thoughts have met their fate. Please tell me I'm not always crazy. Please tell me things make sense. Please tell me I'm going to look back one day and think it was fun to be a teenager. Please tell me I'm not the only person who thinks this. Please, tell me.
tired of your pretty, lyrical, thought-provoking face. When I'm sitting elbow to elbow at a runway show, I want to feel what television and a film and a book and poetry can deliver. Immediacy, fervor, wreckage. When the model spits with rage, I want to feel that spittle. I want to smell your sweat. I want to taste your bile. I want my blood to boil. And I want to feel too overwhelmed after the experience to speak. This, to me, is the power of fashion. It's ugly. It's furious. It creeps into my thoughts long after I've gone. That's why I design. I make clothes that are obsessive, anxiety-ridden, fast-talking. I don't make antiques. I don't sew for history books. I love confusion. I love to watch people flail with passion and intention. This is life. It's a grotesque, furious, freakish pageant. Pay attention, please. I see my profession as the fraught dialogue of naked women with all the hexes and spells in my fabric. It's a lover's quarrel that ends in a murder. Piper. Piper! Are you listening to me? Are your big, blinking eyes soaking this in? Do you want to know what inspires me? Poverty. Terrible, terrible poverty. I spent time in Guatemala. They exist on avocados. They live in shacks with tin roofs, buildings crumbling apart, naked babies squatting in the road, donkeys. But even there, in the muck of moral despair, does an indefatigable humanity, a claws from the depths of pure anguish. That is what inspires me. That is what drives my impulses. That is what feeds my soul. And that, Piper, that is what you lack.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them, to die to sleep, and by sleep to say we end the heartache and thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished, to die, to sleep, perchance to dream. Ah, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the wits and scorns of time? The oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might as quietest make with a bare bucket. Who would fardels bear to grunt and to sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country, from whose burn no traveler returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear these ills than fly to others we know not of. And thus conscience doth make cowards of us all! And thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied over with the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pitch and moment. With this regard, their currents turn awry and lose the name of action.
My dad used to work at a gas company. He used to read meters, but in this letter he says he can't get around so good anymore, so they gave him a different job. Elevator man. Goofy old guy, he used to bring this little frying pan to work every morning and a can of Sterno to cook his own lunch. He said everyone should have a hot lunch. I swear I don't know how he did it. There were four of us, me and my three brothers, and he had to do everything. My mother died. I never knew her. He had to feed us, give us a bath, buy our clothes, everything. That's why my whole life I used to think that someday I'd like to pay him back. Funny how it worked out. One day I brought home $100 and gave it to him.
You know what he did? He threw it in the toilet and pulled the chain. I thought he was gonna hit me, sure, but he didn't. In his whole life, he never hit me. He didn't happen to write me after all these years because I wrote him. He says he's thought about me every day. God, I haven't thought about him once even in 5 years. That's nothing against him. I haven't thought of anything. It'd be nice to see him, but he says he doesn't want to see me if I'm still living the life of a concubine. I looked it up. I just realized I've practically told you my whole life story by now. How about the story of your life?
Now, Rick, sit down. Put down your tambourine. Now, as you know, there's a certain kind of chemistry which can affect two people in very different ways. Now, just as there's some chemistry in you which allows you to like my company, there is some chemistry in me that makes me want to scratch your face off. No? Rick, I'm not going to mince words. It's time for you to leave. We needn't go into all the reasons. Let's just say it's something I've thought about and decided on. Now, I realize you saved my life. I owe you my life. And I also realize that I promised, in writing, that as long as I was alive, you could come to me for anything. And you could always have a place you would forget it.
My name is Toomey, Sergeant Murren J. Toomey, and I am in charge of C Company during the 10 weeks of basic training here in beautiful Biloxi, Mississippi. After which those of you who survived the heat, humidity, roaches, spiders, snakes, dry rot, fungus, dysentery, syphilis, gonorrhea, and tick fever will be sent to some crap island in the Pacific or some turd pile in North Sicily. In either case, returning to your mamas and papas with your balls intact is highly improper. There's only one way to come out of a war healthy body and sane of mind, and that way is to be born the favorite daughter of the President of the United States. I speak from experience, having served 14 months in the North African campaign, where 73% of my comrades are buried in the sand of the Arab Desert. The colorful ribbons on my chest will testify to the fact that my government is grateful for my contribution to... having donated a small portion of my brains to the conflict. The other portion being protected by a heavy steel plate in my head. This injury has caused me to become a smart, compassionate, and sympathetic, understanding, teacher of raw young men, or the most sadistic, cruelest, craziest son of a gun you ever saw. And that's something you won't find out till 10 weeks from now. Do I make myself clear, Epstein?
All right, you worthless bunch of nobodies. Today we're gonna play the one game that makes me happy in life. Dodgeball. Here's the rules. Number one, dodge the ball. Number two, no crying. Number three, if you get hit, you're out. Number four, no crying. Number five, if you're out, sit on the bench. Number six, no crying. Number seven, don't cross the line or you're out. And number eight is no crying. Now remember, throw the ball as hard as you can, and absolutely whatever you do, no crying. Now let's get started. Split into teams and begin. Jimmy, you're out. Sarah, that's an out. Billy, you're out. It hit your foot, what's the difference? Well, you should have dodged it. You heard the rules, dodge or you're out.
It started off like a murder mystery from Blenheim Castle. No one said a word, but everyone looked suspicious. It was so quiet, you could hear Lauren's soup going down her esophagus. Everyone had one eye on their plate and one eye on Pops, besides me. I sat opposite Nora. I kept dropping my napkin a lot so that I could bend down to get a good look at those virginal, creamy, white legs.
Oh,
You could tell she was really deep in thought because she kept leaving herself unguarded. And I got to see halfway up her thighs, which led to the golden palace of the Himalayas. Stanley knew exactly what I was doing because he was the one who taught it to me, but he was busy with his own problems like everyone else. The clock in the kitchen was ticking, and the tension in the air was so thick you could cut it with a knife.
As long as I could remember, I could see them and hear them. They talked to me, sometimes for hours at a time. Nobody else could see them, except Rebecca, my cat. She could see them, but I don't think she could hear them, or else she pretended not to hear them. Rebecca was aloof in the way that most cats are aloof. But when one of the people in the chair was sitting in the chair, Rebecca stayed away. Sometimes she hissed. She didn't want anything to do with the people or the chair, which is a shame. She missed out on some interesting conversations. The people in the chair talked to me before I could answer them. I could answer them in my thoughts, but not with words. Before I could walk or talk, the people in the chair were my friends.
Jason, over here. What are you, an idiot? How many times am I gonna tell you? Stop acting like a dummy and get off the swing. What? What did you say? That's right, you said nothing.
Let me tell you, that kid has a mouth like a sewer. I don't know where he gets it from. I'd have that kid horsewhipped. You can't do that though, can you? They're delicate, aren't they? There are all kinds of sociological factors involved. You smack the kid in the head, next thing you know, he's strolling through an Arby's with a high-powered rifle, and you're to blame. You think I'm kidding? 9 out of 10 experts would agree with me.
Rebellious subjects, enemies to peace, profounders of this neighborhood stained steel, will they not hear? What ho, you men, you beasts, that quench the fire of your pernicious rage with purple fountains issing from your veins. On pain of torture from those bloody hands, throw your mistempered weapons to the ground and hear the sentence of your moved prince. 3 civil brawls, bred of an airy word, by thee, old Capulet and Montague, have thrice disturbed the quiet of our streets and made Verona's ancient citizens cast by their gray beseeming ornaments to wield old partisans in hands as old, cankered with peace to part your cankered hate. If ever you disturb our streets again, your lives shall pay the forfeit of the peace. For this time, all the rest depart away. You, Capulet, shall go along with me, and Montague, come you this afternoon, to know our farther pleasure in this case, to old Freetown, our common judgment place, once more. On pain of death, all men depart.
Kenny, you are not gonna believe this. I'm freaking losing it. Do you see me? I am losing it. It was the pink jogging suit lady at the door. Only she wasn't wearing a pink jogging suit. She was wearing shorts and a blue t-shirt. And she came over to ask us politely, sort of politely, if we could keep our dog from pooping on her lawn. Kenny, we don't have a dog. And so I said to her politely, I said, we don't have a dog. And she said, yes, you do have a dog, and it's quite fond of taking crabs on my lawn. Quite fond? Like slicing a razor blade across my face, quite fond. And I said, lady, do you want to come in my house? We've got nothing in our house, especially a dog. Especially, we don't have a dog. And she said, listen, Missy, freaking Missy, listen, Missy, I've lived in this neighborhood for 6 years and I jog every morning and this dog appeared out of nowhere and started crapping on my lawn. I'm not asking you to get rid of it, I'm just asking you to clean up its crap. And I practically started crying. Look at me, I'm crying now. And I said, ma'am, people have accused me of many things before, but they have never accused me of having a dog. You need to investigate further and knock on other doors. And her voice changed. And she said, look, if it craps on
Mr. Harker. It's been in my family for centuries. There are some fierce battles on this land, and it was always Dracula who prevailed. Dracula, who stood amongst the relentless soldiers of my country, and drew the blood of the Turk, forcing him to retreat over the border into Turkey. They entered in with an air of cockiness. They left scurrying like scared rodents. But they weren't easily daunted. They came back again and again until the fields were soaked with Turkish blood. And that was when Dracula emerged a victor. Dracula emerged conqueror of the Turks! Things are different today, though. Nowadays, words are shed in battle and blood is spared. Men have lost their honor and their pride. Gone are the days when disputes were settled with the sword.
Hey. Hey, here's a story for you. I called my grandparents' place on the telephone one time. Well, I mean, I call the place all the time. I call my grandmother twice a week, just to chat with her. Tell her about my life, tell her about my friends, or boys. I would change a few things just in case. I didn't want to freak her out. Not that I did anything bad. Well, I mean, I tried a cigarette once and I didn't tell her. She would tell me about her day, and her friends, and their grandchildren. She would ask me if I needed money, and I would say no. And then a few days later, she would send me a check for $5. I'd make her laugh when she'd tell me how proud she was of me. And I loved hearing the stories about her past and how different life was growing up in her home country. But anyway, I was gonna tell you about this one time I called my grandparents' place. This is when I was 12. My grandparents died when they were 11. But I called them anyway and just let it ring and ring and ring. They didn't have an answering machine or anything. They're too old for such new things. So I knew it was just gonna ring and ring and ring forever. And it rang and rang and rang forever.
I knew this day was doomed from the moment when Scott first told me he was going to marry Tracy. Tracy, who requested that I not bring Deb, who's my lover of 9 years, to rehearsal dinner, because she wanted to keep it just family. And I acquiesced because I didn't want another big scene. And now Deb is boycotting the wedding, which Tracy has gone out of her way to let me know she is very hurt by. She will never love my little brother the way he deserves to be loved. She'll never honor him and cherish him like she said she would today in front of God and everybody. Just makes me so sad. And now here I am in this ridiculous dress with a freaking pincushion on my head. I look like a hooker from the Twilight Zone, and if I blow chunks, I'm going to be really upset. I hate throwing up. You're totally alone when you throw up.
Getting married is a careless habit I've fallen into. Sometime I must give it all up. Oh, she was pretty though. Blonde. Like the young lady over there. And Southern too, or pretended to be. However, she was kinder than others when we parted. She didn't care about money. All she wanted was to find a new marital bliss with her ball player. So I never had to pay her alimony, as if I could. My second wife was a different type entirely. But she was pretty. I have always exercised the most excellent taste, if not the best judgment. She was a student of mine, when I was teaching at an Eastern university. Alas, she sued me for divorce on the grounds that I was incontinent Anne's always drunk. I didn't have time to resign from that position.
My name is Arnold Wiggins. I'm basically a nervous person. People call me Arnold because I don't have a nickname, so I pretend that when people call me Arnold, I pretend that they're close personal friends who know me by my nickname. Arnold. I live here at the Stonehenge Villa apartment complex in a group apartment with three other guys. Did I mention I'm a nervous person? Well, frankly, I am. Today I went to the market at the end of the street to buy some Wheaties, but I couldn't remember whether I wanted one box or more boxes, so I asked the manager how many I should get. For just you? He said, yes, sir. I said, 17. He said, thank you. I said, but, and this is what I want to emphasize by nervous, I could only find 9 boxes. So what could I do? I bought 9 boxes of Wheaties, and 7 heads of lettuce, that made 16, and 1 bag of charcoal briquettes, that made 17. Oh, and a quart of milk, you know, for the Wheaties. But the more I thought about it, the more I thought I didn't get enough. What was it? Lettuce, Wheaties, charcoal briquettes? This concerned me. So I asked a girl in line what she thought. I can't remember what she said, but she was pretty thorough. And then I got home. Do you think I did the right thing?
We know why you came here. Everything back home is wrong. A few rich white men making loads of decisions for people who are not rich and white and men, and those decisions are always about money. Well, stuff's running out. People are fighting over oil, water, food. Wars are coming, riots, police violence. It's all coming unless we change how we all live. Not just in little token ways, but completely. We have to come up with entirely different ways of living here. And the stuff you were talking about in the conversations we decoded, fairness, equality, it all makes sense. And now we know that. Now we've all read those. We don't belong back there. We can't fit in. We belong here, away from exam results, timetables, choosing what job we should do, trying to fit into a broken system. We should stay because we can help, because we want to, because we're not just little girls anymore, we're people. And we want to change everything, with you. That's why we should stay.
Always here, in this room, with the red door, 127. It was our little place where we go in between classes and any time we could escape. Remember? The love was nice. We were nice as a couple, I think. But it wasn't that kept me coming back. It was your promise of a future. This big, bold future that you'd whispered to me about lying there with your eyes closed. That's what I was in love with. Tomorrow. All the tomorrows you kept offering me. You remember that. I'm sure you do. It was easy enough to say, apparently. All that simple when it's a complete lie. When you have no hope or want of ever seeing it through, then it is whimsical as a fairy tale. And you're good at it, I'll give you that. An expert at making a usually honest, practical woman like me fall for it, gobble it up. Then one single call from a colleague could make that all go away. That courage of yours, your bravado. That's why you write it, I suppose, and teach it to fiction, because it's what you deal in as a person. The irony that I may one day be adding you to a syllabus is not lost on me.
I wanted out of Erie, Pennsylvania. I was turning 17 and didn't want to ride of Erie, Pennsylvania until I was 40 years old. I didn't know anything about Vietnam. That wasn't the point. The point was, I wasn't into a college scene. I wasn't into demonstrations. I wasn't into anything. Religious family, playing with dolls till I was 13 years old. Well, it was a very sheltered time for girls. My high school counselor said to me, "Well now, Sissy, what is it you want to be? A nurse, a teacher, or a secretary?" Oh, well, sir, a nurse, I guess? I'll help mankind. Now my biggest problems my first year in nurse school were, I had no self-control, and I couldn't stand to see people in pain. But my instructor said to me, "You don't have a choice here. You just get in there and do as you're told." So there's this old man in a coma, and I'm supposed to give him a shot of penicillin in his rear end. And now I'm really wrecked, because how can I cause this sick old man more pain? But I'll do it. And the guy immediately comes out of the coma and goes, "Oh my God, save the world.
So, I have this revolver. I hardly ever look at the thing, much less take it out of the box of my dresser. I have no particular affection for it. I'm not exactly a gun enthusiast. But the other day, 3 weeks ago actually, I decided to go take a look at it. So I got the box out. This was in the morning. You were asleep, honey. There was only one bullet in the box. Usually I have four. Don't ask me why. I just arbitrarily decided on four bullets. But now, there was only one. I don't know where the other bullets went. I thought you had found it and shot the other three off somewhere. It doesn't matter at all. The thing was, I took the one bullet and I went downstairs. At first, I thought it was impossible, literally impossible, which is something that fascinated me. It fascinated me more than anything I've seen or done or thought in my entire life. The thought that I myself could do the impossible. The thought that all the millions of possibilities which are seeping around and through my life are tangible. They are tangible, and I can reach out and grasp them and hold them and make them my own. The life that I have, that any of us has, seems like reality, but the fact is, there is no such thing as reality. Reality is an arbitrary construct, and unless we empower it, it in fact ceases to exist. And that makes me happy.
When I was little, my grandmother would sing songs to me that she told me freed slaves. Not physically, but spiritually. She said, singing these songs deep in the night here helped teaching cubs of the slaves run away free into peace, serenity. Let them know that God was there everywhere that they went. Gave them strength and spiritual nourishment. Thus we call them Negro spirituals. She would also add, they say these songs would help guide a slave if they ran away. Mapped out the geography, guided them through the night. Very shy stuff, she would also say, but I don't know about all that. I always wondered why she didn't know about all that. Her admission of ignorance, I later gathered, was because Grandma wasn't there. She wasn't a slave, and neither was her mother. And even if she was, there was no way for her to pass down the direct understanding of what a Negro spiritual like Wade in the Water meant to a slave who had just run away. What she could verify by means of it right now was that they still gave her courage and still gave her strength. You can hear how keep your hand on the plow later became keep your eye on the prize and resulted in yes, we can. So rather than passing down all these maybes to each other, why can't we pass down something that we know to be true? That these songs forged in the shame and brutality of oppression are diamonds that glint and prove that truth and love can live, thrive, and even sing.
When I was 8 years old, my father put my younger sister and me in an old Ford pickup truck and took us to our first baseball game. It was a group of handsome young men from our town playing in the park. They weren't professionals, but oh, how we loved it. Every Saturday, for the rest of our summers, we begged Papa to take us to the park to watch those young men play. When I remember those days, the smell of the grass, the crack of the bat, that's what I miss. Yes, sir, I do miss that.
Well, to begin, I come from this quasi-middle upper or upper middle class family type home. I could never figure out which, but it was real boring. I mean, we had money, but no taste. You know the kind of house AstroTurf on the patio? Anyway, my mother had a lot of card parties and was one of the foremost bridge cheaters in America. My father worked for this big corporation. They used to send him out into the field a lot to drink. Better that than to find him lying on his office floor, but he was okay. I was the strange one. Real, real strange. I used to love to give garage recitals. Bizarre recitals. This one time, I was doing Frankenstein as a musicale. And I spray painted this kid silver. All over. They had to rush him to the hospital because he had that thing where your pores can't breathe. And he lived. luckily I didn't paint the soles of his feet. And as I got older, I kept getting stranger and stranger. I used to go down to this busy intersection near my house at rush hour and direct traffic. I just wanted to see if anybody noticed me. And that's when I started breaking into people's houses. Oh, I didn't steal anything. I just rearranged their furniture. And school? You want to hear about school? I went to P.S. Crap. See, I was the kind of kid that was always getting slammed into lockers and stuff like that. Not only by the students, by the teachers, too. Oh, I hated sports. Hated sports, and sports were very big. I mean, it was Jock City, and I didn't make one team. See, I couldn't catch a ball if it had Elmer's glue on it. And wouldn't my dad have to be this big ex-football hero? He was so humiliated, he didn't know what to tell his friends. So, he told them all I had polio. On Father's Day, I used to limp for him.
Listen to me now. I say I've been wrong, son. That I've been doing to you what the rest of this world has been doing to you. Walter, what you ain't never understood is that I ain't got nothing, don't own nothing, and ain't never really wanted nothing that wasn't for you. There ain't nothing that's precious to me. Nothing worth holding on to, money, dreams, nothing else. If it means it's gonna destroy my boy. I paid the man $3,500 down on the house. That leaves $6,500. Monday morning, I want you to take this money and take $3,000 and put it in a savings account for Benita's medical schooling. The rest, you put in a checking account with your name on it. And from now on, any penny that come out of it or that go in it is for you to look after, for you to decide. It ain't much, but it's all I got in the world, and I'm putting it in your hands. I'm telling you to be the head of this family from now on, like you're supposed to be. You did all you could. You did all you could. That's what they kept telling me. But it wasn't enough. Even if it was true, it wasn't enough. I mean, what's the use? I spent all my life studying and working. I mean, my whole life. No football games, no parties, no guys, nothing but books, labs, and more books, and for what? So this little girl can die right in front of me while I still have my hand on her heart? Nobody understands. Nobody, man. You did all you could. Why don't I feel like I did all I could? That little girl looked up to me with those big brown eyes. She said, Daki, I'm not afraid. You're the best Daki in the world. And when I wake up, I'll be all fixed. She didn't wake up. She didn't wake up, and I can't help blaming myself. That little girl depended on me. She believed in me. I was her God. Some God, huh? I couldn't even move. I just stood there with my hand on her heart, and it just stopped. And I stopped. I just stood there, listening to the monitor's dead tone and trying to hear all at the same time. Yeah.
guess they just forgot this, but I never really liked chocolates very much. I get stomach aches from it, you know? So I gave it to all the other guys on the ward every Christmas. We had this one guy named Wally something who'd eat the chocolates and he would keep them in a box until one day he died and one of the attendants just threw the box away. I mean, it was all Wally owned. This box of the insides of all the chocolates, and they just threw it away. I don't understand, they just threw it away!
I'm afraid I can't tell you my name. I'm incognito. It's of absolute necessity. I have a whole motion picture studio after me, and an entire press corps. Haven't you read the newspaper or listened to the radio? I'm Bettina Barnes? I shouldn't have told you that. I do hope you'll keep my secret. You see, I ran away. You don't know what it's like being exploited by these lousy flesh peddlers and power brokers, them all wanting a little piece. Well, I'm not a pepperoni. I make one great film. Sex kittens go to outer space. The director had a vision, but I had to do 4 sequels. Qual trash. I couldn't go on. They have no respect for the rights of the individual. I mean, isn't that what all human beings desire? Respect? I mean, was it so hard to ask for a script approval or a salary raise? Hardly. So I decided to not show up to the first day of shooting Sex Kittens Go Bossa Nova. Then later, I found out that the producer, Sid Rawson, had a process server show up to my door. I said to myself, that cheap little son of a... He can't do this to me! I'm Bettina Barnes! He slaps me with a subpoena. I'll have his gonads on a plate. I'm no flash in a pan that gives a damn. I'm playing hardball, baby!
Ain't just something how bad these here white folks is getting here in Chicago. Lord is getting so you think you're right down in Mississippi. Of course I think it's wonderful how our people just keep on pushing out. You hear some of these Negroes say they don't go anywhere they not wanted. Well, not me, honey. Wilhelmina Othella Johnson goes anywhere anytime she wants. Yes, I do. Why, if we left it up to these here crackers, the poor niggers wouldn't have nothing. Oh, I always forget you don't have that word in your house.
You touch one strand of that linguine and I'll break every sinus in your head.
I'll tell you exactly what it is. It's the cooking, the cleaning, and the crying. It's the moose calls that open your ears up 2 a.m. in the morning. I can't take it anymore, Florence. I'm cracking up. Everything you do irritates me. And when you're not here, the things I know you're going to do when you come in irritate me. You leave me these little notes on my pillow. We're all out of cornflakes. F you. Took me 3 hours to figure out that F you meant Florence Unger. It's no one's fault, Florence. We're just around here. That's not the picture. That's just the frame. The picture, I haven't even painted yet. Every night in my diary, I write down the things you did that aggravated me. It's June, and so far I've filled up till January, and I haven't even put down the Gazpacho Brothers yet. And don't even get me started on my sex life. I can't even have dirty dreams. You come in and clean them up. It's really beautiful out, unseasonably warm, they keep saying. It's the kind of day where every person steps foot out their door, inhales in unison, and feels like crying a little. Hats and gloves thrown into purses or in backpacks for the evening, but not for the day. The walk to the subway, the walk at lunchtime. Pumpkins on doorways and spicy hot drinks and cider. Way too many apples. But the 70 degrees is the thing that kills. You walk down the leaf-coated street and you think of the one person whose lover you should have been. You think of jumping into a pile of leaves with him in Central Park. Though, never in your adult life have you ever jumped into a pile of leaves. And especially not in Central Park. There could be rats lurking beneath. And certainly not in your horrible fall coat that's one loose thread away from disintegration. But anyways, today, there are no rats, and
Hopes don't fall apart. And the air's meant for eating, and strangers are there for you to touch. And, yeah, the lady in the knee-high brown leather boots and the chocolate corduroy skirt, she's yours. And the man in the square-toed shoes with the Times folded beneath his arm, blowing out his coffee, waiting for the light to change, he's yours too. And your lover, the one you never had, he's waiting for you. He's lying in a pile of leaves beneath the bend. His arms are outstretched. And maybe for a second, everything is as it should be. And maybe I don't hate myself. Mom, I think I inherited that from you. So you can take the hate back, all of it. I'm done with it.
I'm not gonna let you hurt me, Nora. I'm not gonna let you tell me that I don't love you, or even try to give you as much as I gave Lori. God knows I'm not perfect because enough angry people in this house told him so tonight. But I am not gonna be a doormat for all the frustrations or unhappiness that you or Aunt Kate want to lay at my feet. I did not create this universe. I don't decide who lives or dies, or who's rich or poor, or who feels loved and who feels deprived. If you feel cheated that Lori gets more than you, then I feel cheated that I had a husband who died at 36. And if you keep on feeling that way, you'll end up with something much worse than loneliness or helplessness, and that's self-pity. Believe me, there is no leg that is more twisted or bent that is more crippling than a human being who thrives on his own misfortunes. I'm sorry, Nora, that you feel unloved, and I will do everything I can to change that, but I won't apologize for it. I am tired of apologizing. After a while, it becomes your life's work, and it doesn't bring any money into the house. But if it's taken your pain and Aunt Kate's anger to get me to start living again, then God will give me the strength to make it up to you. But I will not go back to being that helpless, frightened woman that I created. I've already buried somebody that I love, and now it's time to bury somebody that I hate.
You know, I really do feel like I'm not the kind of person that gets off on looks or more like the physical side of men, but when it's the other way around, it totally hurts. Can you imagine what he's actually thinking about my body? And this isn't about sex or anything, not really, but how he sees my legs or my arms, anything. Okay, yes, I'm thinking about all the rest of it too. Of course I am. The words he used to describe my boobs or my butt, it's too much, it is. I can't even start to go there without wanting to throw up. I've always felt like my face was one of my okay parts, and keeps talking about me like I'm some old Buick in the backyard that he keeps thinking about fixing and can't get around to yet. Meant as a compliment, he says. Like, that's supposed to calm my nerves or something? So, I mean, screw that. Really, screw that. I'm realistic, and I know me as a person. I don't have much going for me. Not all smart and educated or anything. Not all gorgeous like some girls, but I'm proud of what I've got, and I'm gonna protect that. Yeah, I am. I mean, wouldn't you?
Dear Lord, I'm here before you to honor this cat who I don't really know, but I found in the street outside my apartment where some bastard hit her with his car and then just left her for carry-on. I call her Rosa because I don't know her real name, and I like the name Rosa. What do we know about Rosa? We know that she is one of your creations and therefore precious. We know, in fact, that she was much more worthy in your eyes than the bastard who probably got her as a kitten because she was cute, but didn't take even a second to consider that getting a cat is a lifelong responsibility. So he just tossed her out of his car onto Foothill Boulevard when he got bored with her, where the chances of her surviving even 2 days are about nil, because Foothill Boulevard, for Christ's sake, that's a busy street, and if she isn't hit by a car, she's going to get sick or eaten by a coyote. Whatever. What we know is that Rosa, even though I never met Rosa while she was alive, I could tell, anyone could tell just by looking at her lifeless corpse, that she was a purebred Maine Coon, which is one of the most beautiful breeds of cat you ever got to place on this earth. We can tell she was a Maine Coon by the distinctive dark patches over her eyes and the nose, which seems a bit longer than would be considered show quality. Okay, she probably wasn't a purebred Maine Coon, but she was clearly...
Holy crap, she's a raccoon! What the hell am I doing petting a raccoon over here?
Sorry. Didn't mean to bother you over a raccoon. I gotta wash my hands. Sorry, God. Sorry. Go back to whatever you were doing. I'll take care of the raccoon. Throw this in the dumpster. Sorry, Lord. Sorry.
Pie, that reminds me of something, and I don't know why. I was 18. I was traveling to Italy with my girlfriend. She was 17. We had about 6 months of experience between us. We had no money. I don't know how we got there, but can you imagine? 18 in Italy with nothing but a t-shirt and a bag, one watch between us, not one word of Italian, a compass! We thought that would be useful, like we'd suddenly be helped if we knew north. It was August like nobody's business. So hot you cry eggs in the air. We decided to sleep in the park next to the Colosseum, cars all night long. We bought a bottle of white wine, screw top, from the Italian market. We drank it, it tasted bad. We got drunk, in the park, sleeping bags, love, that night, 18. We kept the bottle, took it with us, took it back with us. Later, we found out it was olive oil.
Personally pay off all that travesty. And then
I wonder why I didn't go to law school, med school, or anything with a future school. But in the dark, I can get away from everything. I can dream.
Put it this way, okay? The train is out of control. It's on a track heading for 5 people. You can flip a switch, which sends the train down a different track, or you can do nothing. What do? You get involved. You flip the switch and save who you can, because it's the right thing to do. I protected who I could from the world out there, from you and your ridiculous ideas. You wanted us to go home, to abandon the only thing that's ever been any good to us. To change the whole world? That's not saving anyone. That's just not realistic. Everything I've ever done was for the good of these people. I gave them choice from responsibility, choice, ideas. I can't just go back to being me. Please, Han. Please. Oh God, oh my God. It's a nerve spasm. I get them in my neck. A towel, give me a hot towel, very hot. Aspirin is good, and some brandy. I can't move my neck. And a scarf, a woolen scarf. Cashmere is better if you have one, actually. I knew something was coming, Olive. I knew we were in trouble. In the middle of the night, I would tiptoe into the bathroom and I would pray, please, God, help me save my marriage. Please, God, tell me what I'm doing wrong. Tell me what to do. Please, God, help me. And then I hear Sydney in the bedroom saying, please, God, make her shut up. Tell her to be quiet, please, God. I'm not a complainer. I never once tried to change Sydney. He wears a toupee two sizes too big. He looks like an English sheepdog. I never said a word. He's also into cowboy boots. 5'3½". He wears cowboy boots. They go up to his knees. He looks like he jumped off a 100-foot horse. He's also into languages. He's studying Russian at the new school. Instead of yes, he says, duh. Everything is duh. I'm married to a 5'3" man with an oversized toupee and boots up to his knees who walks around saying, duh. And he walks out on me?
He's like nuts or something. He'd be my friend too. And Barry, he'd be gone now. I miss Barry. Joe, I miss Barry. I stand before you, a middle-aged man in an uncomfortable suit. A man whose capacity for rational thought is somewhere between a 5-year-old and an oyster. It's hard. Damaged. Sick from so many hours and days and months and years of confusion, utter and profound confusion. Mystified by faucets and radios and elevators and newspapers and popular songs. I can't always remember the names of my parents, but I will not go away. And I will not wither because the cage is too small. I am Lucian Percival Smith. Without me, my shattered, crippled brain may never be frightened by what you might become. Or indeed, by what your future might make you.
It's the very best place in the world. I go there whenever things get crazy, like they seem to get a lot. I go there, and I close my door. And I lock myself with all my stuff, and I just feel safe. Like nothing and nobody can hurt me. It's my special place, a place where I can be free. I think everybody needs a place where they can go and be alone, away from people for a few minutes, to be alone and to do and think whatever they want, especially older people.
so uptight, so crazed, you know? Everyone in the world deserves a place, a private place, where they can go and just be who they need to be. It's just everything seems so rushed, so intense, like nobody wants to be private anymore.
Most of the time. I just thought you might want to know, so you know, don't worry about me or anything. Come on, Doug, just wake up. Just wake up now. It's been a long time, I know, and I just wanted to... Jesus, what the hell am I doing here? I'm so sick of your...
Genius? But getting up on the roof in the middle of a freaking electrical storm isn't a right freaking move. You know, I'm trying not to swear so much. And I'm moisturizing. So that's what's going on with me. Congratulations on almost getting married. I mean, I heard about it. I heard about her. Elaine. She sounds lovely. Poor girl. You probably made the right decision, though. I mean, I don't think you're going to be ready to settle down until you stop climbing up on the roof, you know? I mean, I'm no model citizen, but I do know basic frickin' things about personal safety. You dumb piece of... So stupid being here right now. I was pretty sure I'd get here, say two words to you, and you'd snap out of it. Because it's me. It's Kayleen, Dougie. Last time I saw you, just blown out your stupid eye. It was the same hospital. Twice in 10 years. Not stellar for a couple of kids supposed to be best friends. Twice. Of course, this is 3 times. Does this count? Does it count if one of us might be brain dead? Of course, you always have been brain dead, Dougie, haven't you? I am retarded. Your hands are all dry. You can't marry that girl, Doug. You can't. You just can't. Because what about me? What about me, huh? When my dad died, that stuff you said to me, you're always doing that, you know? The top 10 best things anyone's ever done for me, they've all been done by you. And I know. I'm so stupid. I'm messed up. You know that. And so I need you to stick it out for me, Dougie. I'm gonna need you to come find me. I'm sorry, but you have to wake up now. You have to wake up for me. Because I'm not great, you know? I'm really not great. And I really just need you right now. Okay? I need you to come over and show me some stupid stuff. Tell me some stupid joke like you always do. I'm sorry, I've been gone. But I'm back now, you know? I'm back now. So, you know, just wake up. And shine. It's Tuesday. That was always your favorite day.
At the end of the year, but for right now, this is their last monologue night, and they did a
a fabulous job, and for the freshman, your first monologue night, incredible job. And the sophomores, you rocked it tonight.
Yeah!
Claude Little Shop of Horrors is March 8th, 9th, and 10th. Please come and see the show and tell your friends, and thank you, and have a great night. Drive safe.